a human being who really walked God's walk for all of us to be fully involved. It's always a pleasure to be speaking before God's family today. I think I said now that Pastor Kelly isn't here. She's always been very open in being able to open this pulpit up for someone such as myself to share the word of God. And today's word is about wisdom, making the most of time. Share a small story with you. Arianna Huffington, how many people heard her name before know who she is? So she's the co-founder of the Huffington Post and the author of a book called Thrive, where she stated, quote, "The quest for knowledge may be pursued at higher speeds with smarter tools today, but wisdom is found no more readily than it was 3,000 years ago in the court of King Solomon. In fact, ours is a generation bloated with information and starved for wisdom." Huffington was in quite a unique position to know this, because for years she enjoyed tremendous success in terms of money, power, and influence, until 2007, when she suddenly collapsed from exhaustion. Through this experience, she learned that her life and her definition of success needed to change. Starved for wisdom, bloated with information. Yes, we are starved for wisdom. In the reading today, thank you, Bruce, for reading from 1 Kings. Some background is David's older son, Absalom, had tried to overthrow his father in a coup. And Absalom had gained allies in the northern part of the kingdom, which was then known as Israel, while David's power base relied in the southern part, which was known as Judah. In that battle, Absalom was killed by David's soldiers, and David the king was also David the father, stricken with grief. Because this was the second son that he had who had died. So, as time passed, David the king, who was credited for uniting both the northern and southern kingdoms together, had died. And he chose his son Solomon to be the next ruler of the land. But Solomon was young, and though we read in the passage he says he's a child, he's a little older than that, but he's in his early 20s. If you can imagine what Prince William and Prince Harry are about that age. But he was inexperienced both as warrior and a ruler. He was very unsure of himself, how to rule a nation that was just being formed. So he went to Gibeon, a very sacred site to worship and offer sacrifice. And while he was at Gibeon, God spoke to him in a dream, offering Solomon whatever he wished from God, whatever he asked from. Now, I take a small detour, because this always reminds me of my childhood when I heard about Aladdin and the Lamp. Aladdin and the Lamp, if you can remember, he came to him and offered him three wishes, right? And I don't know how old I was when I thought about this, but as I got a little older, maybe a year later after I heard the story, I was like trying to be extra clever and say, I want to wish for 1,000 more wishes to come true. Why limit yourself to three? That shows me why I don't have wisdom today. Trying to be greedy. But the fascinating part of this biblical story is it gives us an opportunity to put ourselves in the shoes of Solomon and how he responded to this offer. What would it have been like if God offered you what you wanted? Now, we read this story and we find that Solomon gave the quote-unquote right hand. could have asked for more money. We all could use more of that. The church could use it if you don't think you need. He could have asked for a long and healthy life. And I thank you, Willie, for sharing how your aunt is 101. Should we all be blessed in that way? He could have asked for a really good job. Could have asked for success, not just for himself, but for his offspring. And if you didn't want to be self-centered, you could have asked for world peace. All these things would have been admirable things to ask for. No one would besmirch you if you didn't ask those things from God. But it's really interesting how he asked for wisdom. Now, I can tell you how making this kind of request can go awry. I'll tell you a small story about a small town in which there were two boys who were constant rivals throughout their childhood. And then as they grew, they became small entrepreneurs. And they actually had a small but successful store on each side of town. And so different wares. And from their childhood all the way until they were adults, they were always in dispute, trying to outdo each other. And it really became unhealthy because it became a healthy dislike for each other. So God was really tired of their bickering. And he sent an angel down to speak to them. And he spoke to one of the gentlemen who said, and the angel offered to give him a gift. Now, this gift would be whatever you wish for, you would receive. But the balance is that your rival would have it in twice the amount. If you ask for $1 million, he's going to get it to you. If you ask for a 5,000 square foot house, he's going to have a 10,000 square foot house. If he asks for a beautiful wife, no, he's not going to give it to you. He's just going to try it. If you ask for a long life, his is going to be even longer. So the man went away and thought about it for a while, and he thought, wow, what a wonderful blessing God is offering me. And yet I cannot get over that my rival will get more than me. So the morning he woke up and the angel said, what is your request? And he told the angel, strike me blind in one eye. Think about that. So that's where that can go awry, if your hate and you're wanting to see your rival be below you. So in today's reading, what we find is that we are counseled to live wisely in every opportunity. That we are dared to see the time that we have is time to both praise and serve God in everything we do. And we are to make the most of our time means that we need to know what God wants us to do. We need to know what God wants us to do. So in Proverbs it says we are not to lean to our own understanding, that God will direct our paths and show us the way. We have this time in our lives where it truly is being overwhelmed with information. I listened to a program the other day where we have so much information that it does us a disservice because we want to slice and dice what fits our, I won't say prejudices, our preferences. And you just continue to get more information that doesn't necessarily give you an objective, it just supports what you think and you feel. And so, if we really want truth, objective wisdom, we have to open ourselves up for things that may seem foolish to the world, and yet genuine beauty. And that is what we have in Jesus' life. Jesus showed us that too often We can be led to believe that rules and regulations give us the proper way to deal with each other. Crime and punishment, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. No one is going to get over on me. The punishment always needs to fit the crime. But God's way of looking at things, according to Jesus, is way beyond our attempts to get even, as I shared in the story of the two shopkeepers. That Christ served as a shepherd who laid down his life for those who didn't deserve it or even understood it. So we have this gift of wisdom that helps us to live our lives to whatever abundance and eternity that God has promised us, so that we can start seeing things from God's perspective. That we can hold on tightly to all our possessions, to all of the things that we think are important, and realize that God has something greater for us. In the poem, it says that we wanted so much more to our heart's desire, but God is wiser. So this world can jerk us around all kind of ways, up and down, to be what they want us to be. That new car, that new house, that new job, that new technology. And Jesus says something different. He says, and I'm paraphrasing from Matthew, come to me, all who are having a tough time, because the work I offer you will be given to you with wholeness and peace. If we can only find ourselves to be whole, when we say whole, to be at peace, we know that we are walking with God. To share you a small story that goes with a young man who was on a business trip, and he went to bring back some souvenirs for his wife. And one of them was just this little small matchbox that is the glow in the dark. And when she opened it, it turned out that there was nothing in light, but it didn't glow. And so she said to her husband, there's something wrong here. It doesn't glow at all. And the man thought he had been cheating. And then the wife noticed something that was in a different language, and she went and found out that it was actually written in French at the bottom of the box and had it translated. And she took it to a friend who knew French, and they told her that, if you want me to shine at night, keep me in the daylight, in the sunlight all day. So when the woman set her gift out of the south window, this matchbox then had a brilliant glow to it that shined all through the night. This story is not so much different than ourselves. When we want to glow with God's love and God's wisdom within us, we can let ourselves be exposed to everything he has to offer. The trials, the tribulations, the blessings to overcome. And that his teachings in our lives, in our walking experience, in the scriptures that he has, help us to sing the hymns of faith, to reflect on the saints that went before us, and know that our lives now in the present are a gift that we give to others. Let us wake up to the truth, church, so that every moment we have is God's gift to us, and that we can make the most of our time, and that our time, when it belongs to God, can give us joy and give us peace, and that we can rest in the Lord, and that he can feed us, and he can nurture us, he can guide us, and he will make our way clear. So by this, the light of God is given to us in his Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, so that in this dark and needy world that is bloated with information, that blessed to be 101, but if we are to die today, we know that the Lord is with us and that we will see a brighter day after. So the grace and the power of God says, this can